On the board, we just wrote down the, written down the historical facts, some of the historical background. If you want to write it down, cool. If not, catalog it or something, look at it. But in terms of the author, scholars really have no controversy over Paul as the original genuine author of Romans. I know there's been some debate, I guess, recently about the genuine letters of Paul and those that are pseudo-Pauline. This one seems to not conflict with any of that. The date written, due to an indication in Acts as well as in Corinthians, it can be deduced that this letter was written by Paul while he was in Corinth on his third missionary journey. And this dates the letter at between 57 and 60 AD. Further research leads us to Romans 15. Sorry, I'm stepping on toes because we just got 1 to 8. But it is inferred that Paul is nearly approaching a return to Jerusalem. However, by glancing through the dates of the other letters, we can see that Romans was written after the letters of Thessalonians and the letters to Galatia. Yet, it's placed at the beginning of the letters in the context of the canonized text of the New Testament. And we think that this is due maybe to the vast length of the book compared to the other letters, but more poignantly because it probably contains a comprehensive and basic theological framework for understanding and getting an idea of the rest of the Pauline letters. I had just mentioned where it was written. It was written in Corinth on Paul's third missionary journey, and we get that because there's reference to several Corinthian citizens, such as Gaius, I think is the name, in Romans 16:23, and also Phoebe in 16:1. It is generally safe to say that Romans was written in or around Corinth. In terms of who the book was sent to, the letter was sent to, it can be understood when looking at Romans 1-7 that the audience he seems to write to is all in Rome, all the people that are in Rome. He quotes that. In reviewing the long gospel content of the letter written prior to the Romans, as well as to the verbiage in Romans, it would seem that Paul's main audience was the Gentiles. But in 2:17, he also seems to address any Jews who are in the area. I'll just kind of read that real quick. And in 2:17, he just mentions the Jews and the law and what they've experienced in terms of circumcision. He mentions just about everything that's going on in Rome. And we'll get to that in just a little bit. In terms of, finally, why the book was written, being that as you read through Romans, especially the first 8 chapters, you get a really good idea that it's the basic, simple presentation of the salvific event, of the law and the gospel, of what sin is in the will of man and what the gospel is in the will of God, and that saving grace that comes through Christ. It's the justification through faith alone, and the relationship that was played out at the time between the Jews and Gentiles through the universal call to holiness in God's plan after Christ's death and resurrection. And then we're going to move on to the chief concerns and teachings, and we got 2 points on there. And those are the main points of Romans 1-8.
Luther says in his introduction to his commentary on Romans, in his regular bombastic kind of blasting style, he says, "The chief purpose of this letter is to break down, to pluck up, and to destroy all wisdom and righteousness of the flesh." So right off the get-go, Luther is really hammering the second use of the law, the theological use of the law, and Romans is really bringing that out. We can see in Romans 3:19, Paul saying, "Now that we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin." And so throughout Romans, we can see Paul going back and forth, law, gospel, law, gospel, law, and gospel. And in fact, Romans really forms the background or the backbone of our Lutheran confessions and the Reformation. Our righteousness comes by faith, as it says in Romans 3:22. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe, and there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So we also have Paul making these dichotomies. He's going to make, you know, separations between the Jew and the Gentile. And man and woman, and those who live an outwardly righteous life and those who don't. And he's going to say it doesn't matter, because he's pointing to Christ throughout this letter. We are no longer slaves to sin, but now we live in Christ. And in fact, we can even call ourselves slaves to righteousness. That's in 6:19. And he says, I put this in human terms because you are weak in your natural selves, just as you used to offer other parts of your body in slavery to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer them in slavery to righteousness leading to holiness. So Paul describes, and you can see this in other letters, as Paul describing himself as a slave now to Christ, to contrast that he had been a slave to sin before. And one thing that you're going to notice when you read Romans that's really important is that Paul really emphasizes kind of the what now. Now you're justified. What now? Does that mean that you can keep going on sinning? And you can sin all the more so the grace may abound? And he says no. And he even goes further and says, is the law sin because it leads to sin? And that's at 8:19. That's at the end here. He says, the Greek, I think I got the wrong verse. All right, but throughout the letter we can kind of see that the relationship that we're having to God now, and Luther once said, when he was talking to his doctor father, who said, throughout Luther's strugglings, you know, don't keep beating yourself up, just love God. And Luther said, love God, sometimes I hate him. So we can see even from Luther that this kind of struggle with sin and justification, I mean, this is something that we all go through, and for Luther it was a great comfort to read through Romans and find out, you know, now you're alive in Christ, you have something different working in you. And that's kind of what Paul is really emphasizing too, is that you've got a new spirit working in you, and there's kind of this battle between flesh and mind, he says. And the flesh wants to do the one thing, and the mind wants to do, you know, what it's kind of been made to do now is to love God. So now we're going to go through the key chapters and verses.
You should clip this on. I should have given it to you sooner.
Oh, okay. Should we start over?
No, don't. Yeah, just pull your shirt out a little bit.
Okay.
No. We're holding your hand.
Don't dip it.
Sorry.
That's okay. No, we'll move on to key chapters and verses, and there's just a few that we haven't touched on. Okay. Thank you. The first one, right off the bat, is Romans 1:16. It says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of salvation for all those who believe. Another one is 2:11. God is impartial to the person. His grace is blanketed over all. And I've kind of paraphrased these just to make it kind of quick so I don't have to keep turning. 3:23, we've all sinned and we've all fallen short, but justification by faith comes freely in and by the name of Jesus Christ. Romans 5:8, yet when we were still sinners, Christ interceded in death for that same sin. In turn, life expounds. That life through Christ, that eternal life. 5:20, where sin deepens, there it shows us the actual depth of Christ's blood. 6:23, Romans 6:23, we deserve death through sin, but the free gift of God is just the opposite, true and eternal life in Him. Romans 7:15, I have no idea why I do what I do, but I seem to do it anyway. What I know is right to me, I do just the opposite. And then two more quick verses, and these are all key/memorable verses that we've all probably run across somewhere along the line. Romans 8:28, God works good in all things for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. And finally, Romans 8:38, nothing can ever separate us from the love that is in Christ our Lord. So we'll move on to the contemporary applications.
Unless you have some more verses.
Yeah.
Just kind of another flyby. And you guys can just kind of turn to these in your Bibles if you'd like to. Romans 1:24, you can see the consequence of sin, and I don't know if a lot of people think of this, but it says, therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. And a lot of people who aren't Christians really enjoy this kind of lifestyle. And Paul is saying right here that this is a curse. This is you know, what happens with sin. God just let them go on sinning, and that's their curse. And that's really kind of a horrible punishment. And he's God is letting this, you know, the pagans heap coals upon themselves. And he says he gave them over to shameful lust. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural relations. And in the same way, men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. And this would be something that's unheard of to Jews. And it's so horrible. Paul is saying, you know, this is what happens when God just lets you sin. So he's kind of building up for this is the purpose of the law. And he says, since they didn't think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he just gave them over to a depraved mind. So it's a really terrible curse. And then we have kind of the law and gospel. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew and then for the Gentile, because the Jew was given the law and the good news first, God, you know, through Abraham. But then glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew, because the Jews find out about it first, and then for the Gentile, finds out about it second. God does not show favoritism. And then Paul goes into kind of an interesting argument on circumcision, and we see this throughout his letters in talking about circumcision. And he says right here that it has no value, or it has value if you observe the law, but if you break the law, it doesn't have any value. I mean, you've been marked, you've been set aside by your circumcision as one for God, but you're not living like it. So he says, a man is not a Jew if he's only one outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward or physical. You have to live a circumcised life, is his point. And then in 3, we really see Paul's use of rhetoric. And this is something that a lot of scholars really like to look at, is Paul's use of rhetoric, because they're pointing back to, you know, what happened during these other 12 years, how was Paul trained. And we can kind of see, you know, a classical education here in his use of rhetoric. And a great quote is, someone might argue, if my falsehood enhances God's truthfulness and so increases his glory, why am I still condemned as a sinner? Why not say, as we are being slanderously reported as saying, and some even claim to say, let us do evil that good may result. Their condemnation is deserved. So he's really using a lot of rhetorical questions, and he's even getting kind of sarcastic, almost mean right here. And then the famous, no one is righteous, and he's quoting the Old Testament, no one is righteous, not even one. This is at 3:10. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away, all have become worthless. He's really emphasizing man's condition of depravity, and this is what Calvin's really like. Luther liked it too. One of the words that I really like is in 3:25. If you look at the Greek, God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement. He's using the word helisterion, the sacrifice that appeases God's wrath. That's what Christ is, and I wrote that up on the board. But that's a really important point. Paul is saying that we can't appease God's wrath. There's only one thing that can, and that's Christ. And he's even using the technical term from the Old Testament, the cover, the propitiation cover to the Ark of the Covenant. So that's kind of neat. I think I have one more point. Paul makes the point that we were enemies of God, and since we've been justified, we're no longer enemies. And that's at 5. And we can have peace and joy with God. We don't have to live in fear. Well, we live in fear, but we don't have to live, you know, as one who's going to face eternal damnation anymore. We have peace with the creator of the universe, the one person that can, you know, blot us out in the wink of an eye. And then he goes to the famous, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. We've all heard that. Then he kind of, towards the end of chapter 5, he's talking about the marvelous nature of the gift at 15. But the gift is not like the trespass. The gift isn't like the sin, the one sin. If the many died by the trespass, the gift of God is not like the result of the sin either. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. So the one gift that Christ gives us blots out absolutely everything. And then in 6, I think we've already talked about this, shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? And Paul says, no, we died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? If we really are justified, then the same grace that works our justification is going to work our sanctification. So that's something really important, because a lot of other denominations really kind of say you have to be sanctified and then you're justified. And even if you're sanctified, that doesn't mean you're justified. So they've got it all wrong. And it, you know, if you read Romans, it puts it back in the right order. And that's something that we need to constantly kind of think about, is we're justified, then we're sanctified, and grace works both. I think that's all. He ends with a more than conquerors. And all things, we're more than conquerors for him who left us today.
Hey, thank you. And then we'll move into the contemporary applications. And I think we've pretty well hit the nail on the head in terms of this, just by going through Romans. It's pretty straightforward and clear at what Paul is teaching, not only the people in Rome, but the readers of the letters even to this day. In terms of the contemporary application that I found, which we did these projects independently, and Timmy's might have found something a little different, but I'll present what I had. Tradition and favored status shows no guarantee as to the judgment of God. Whether Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, even to this day, Sunday Christian, Life Christian, EC Christian, Easter Christmas Christian, whatever you have, there's equality under sin. As people of man, we are undeserving of an eternal life with Christ and are subject to death and guilt, passed from generation to generation. Yet, by God's saving righteousness, the gospel is the word concerning and is the Son of God, who became flesh, suffered, and was glorified for all. Thus, in Christ and the power of the water and the word, we have moved from people of man or of the world to people of the Lord. We have moved from the life of disillusion and spiritual disturbance to a life concerning peace and hope. So as people of the Lord, works are the result of God's righteousness, and that works are the outflowing of that righteousness, which is completely faith. Those same works and that same righteousness are evident in the church today, as it was at the time that Paul presented this letter. Yes, the law is still binding us, but as soon as the man is freed from the sin, he is also freed from the law. And that comes from good works on Romans. So,
I think Tom pretty well covered it. The one thing that I want to emphasize again, in as far as contemporary applications go, is Paul's reliance on his baptism. And Paul refers back to his baptism as assurance that he will be raised to new life. And whenever the dread of sin, death, or the devil creeps up, you can take comfort in your baptism, kind of like Luther did. He would put his hand on the wall and say, "You've been getauft, I'm baptized." You know? So you can just take great comfort in it. And that's kind of one of the things that Matthew and the other passages in the Gospels don't emphasize about baptism, is this comfort that you can really take in it. And Paul really picks up on that, that it washes away your sin, and you die with Christ in your baptism, and you're resurrected with him. And every time you're feeling, you know, terribly distraught and under the burden of sin, you can remember that and take comfort in it. And then righteousness comes from faith, not from works. You don't have to carry your bag of good works, which maybe some denominations like the Catholics will say God gave you, to the pearly gates, and present them and hope that you have enough to get in. You don't have to work for your salvation. Your sanctification, your good works flow from your justification. You're already saved. And Paul, you know, throughout has been emphasizing that. So,
you go.
Yeah. Can we move on?
Yeah. Contemporary. Commentary addenda. Some things that I had found. I looked at the Interpreter's Dictionary of the Bible, and it argues that there are three chief purposes as to why Paul writes the Romans. First, traditionally, and we kind of said something about this in the beginning in terms of historical background, but we could say that Paul is simply writing to gain support and establishing himself in Rome. However, there's two alternative purposes, and they are as follows. The second one is, Paul is not trying to gain support, but is intervening within the Roman congregation between the Gentile Christians and the Jewish Christians. Now, whether that's true or not, I'm not sure. It's debated at this point. And the third chief purpose that, that might be an alternative view as to why Paul wrote this letter was that Paul has the mindset of this non-intervention style, an establishment of a foundation of the gospel, which he has been entrusted to. But for Paul, no congregational foundation exists in Rome at this point, and he seeks to establish that foundation. So these are all kind of, I guess, thrown around at this point with scholars, but I had just thought that was kind of interesting in terms of the reasons why Paul might have written this letter. The second point that, that I have found, which concerns Paul's speech. And Dunn mentions that Paul's speech in Romans is an indicator not of this cosmic speculation, as may have been familiar at the time, but of a decisive certainty that all have been atoned for. Paul demonstrates a Jewish understanding and participation in the idea of sin and death entering the world through Adam. Paul says that death is the consequence of sinning and not in the will of God at the beginning of creation. In chapter 5, and unlike Jewish thought at the time, Paul deals with the issues of sin and death completely independently, which circumvent the next few chapters of the text. They kind of follow at that from that point. So,
I took from Luther again, and he says, concerning the matter of redemption, God does not want to redeem us through our own, but through external righteousness and wisdom, not through one that comes to us from the outside, not through one that originates here on earth, but from one that comes from heaven. And Dunn kind of says the same thing, along the same lines. The power of sin affects and exercises its authority over the individual. Righteousness is the power of God to retain the individual believer in his sway. So this righteousness is kind of working on us, keeping us on the straight and narrow. And so this, I mean, this really gets back to the Reformation. The justification is extranos, and sanctification is also. So just kind of the theme that, that Paul works with.
I think we could go through our bibliographies, but that'd be kind of boring. So finally, I guess we'll end on the personal key insight as to what maybe we had gained or learned from going through Romans 1 to 8. And mine is kind of just as we had presented before in the chief concerns. You know, what grace is offered to all. We were once dead to sin, but have been raised to new life in the waters of baptism, renewing the spiritual death to a new life in Christ our Lord. Deeds are the outcropping of this faith that is ingrained so deep into our hearts, a depth only measured by the depth of Christ's redemptive blood. And it's always a nice thing going back to the basics, law and gospel, and realizing what Christ has done for us. So,
just again, the extranos, our justification is worked upon us. Our sanctification is worked upon us. We can even look at our baptism and see that we're washed from the outside. And by looking at all these things that take place on the outside, we can look at these things and know that it's not us. We can take comfort in it's Christ working on us. So it's just very comforting. And that's all.
Do you have any questions?
No? I have a question. If you would please, since you did mention the hilasterion on the board there, the propitiation or the expiation concept, would you expound a little bit on that? You mentioned it refers to the covering, but go a little bit more so that the class has the benefit of your research on that.
Well, it's the hilasterion, the cover, the blood is sprinkled on it, and that's kind of this.
That's the mercy seat in the Ark of the Covenant you're talking about. Okay, fine, continue.
So the blood is sprinkled on this, and it's the sacrifice that satisfies God's wrath. So first of all, we need to think of our condition before God as sinners, and God's wrath is turned against us. And it burns against us, and then Christ has washed away that wrath with his blood. And that's just, Paul is looking back and pointing out, this is what they did in the Old Testament. They had this blood, they had to do this every year, and Christ comes, his blood washes away forever. All the sins past, all the sins future.
Okay, it's based on the concept that the wages of sin is death. And since we've all sinned, we all deserve to die. And so there needs to be a substitute, if indeed we don't all die eternally. And the animal sacrifice in the Old Testament was a temporary kind of way of showing the need for that substitution in the animal's blood.
that was actually the taking of its life, then you see the life is in the blood, was put upon the mercy seat on the Ark of the Covenant to show then that through that sacrifice the sins of humanity are covered. Beneath the lid of the Ark of the Covenant was a table of the law which had been broken by human sin. And then eventually Christ gives the perfect sacrifice, not an animal sacrifice, but a human sacrifice, because only a human could atone for a human, and of course only the Son of God could atone for humanity. So he becomes the final sacrifice, the propitiation for our sins, or the mercy seat, as it were, that atones before God. So it's a complicated picture, but Romans 3, verse 21 to 26, certainly one of the high points of this book, goes into that just a little bit. Well, thank you very much for your report. You've gone into great detail and very helpfully so. The temptation would be to finish Romans off, but the Romans epistle is such a rich epistle that I'm afraid that probably what I have to say now would be obscured later after the brilliant report we expect from the other Timothy. So I'm going to say a few things about the first half of the book before calling on Timothy to give us the last part of the book, because it does shift gears rather dramatically, as Tim will tell you. As you know, this is a highly doctrinal work. Romans is probably the most doctrinal work in the New Testament, because Paul had not been to Rome at this time. It was his destination to get there so that he might eventually go on to further mission work in Spain. He looked for, well, we'll let Tom tell you more about that later, but he wants them to have a full exposition of the gospel, and that's why you receive such a detailed report here. Paul gives us a detailed report, gives the basics of the good news and the need for it. All men are consigned under sin, therefore, of course, gospel is necessary for all humanity. The one doctrine, perhaps, of the major doctrines that is not covered here would be the Lord's Supper, but probably all the major doctrines in some way are touched upon in this epistle, in which he wants to give them an advance awareness of the gospel that he's been proclaiming and its various implications. So that's why the great detail. Just want to support basically what you said before. Obviously it's been said elsewhere in the notes you have from day one. In Romans 1, 16 and 17 are usually considered to be the theme of the work. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And then let me dwell a little bit on what is a real Jew. A Jew, as Paul develops the idea, and he's probably trying to reach out to some of the Roman Jews who have become candidates for the faith, or who have associated with the church in Rome that apparently was already in being before Paul got there. He's wanting them to be genuine believers rather than believers of a sort that well, the Pharisees were, where, you know, they believed that to be Jewish was enough. No, a real Jew, one who is really an offspring of Abraham, who is defined by his faith rather than by his ethnicity, is one who understands the gospel and who puts himself under the gospel and the mercies of God, which is a means of salvation. The idea of righteousness as defined in chapter 3 is probably nowhere more clearly defined in the New Testament than there, as Timaeus and Tom have already talked about how this expiation works and how God passed over the sins that are of the former time in light of the forgiveness that would be worked out in complete form by Jesus in his public ministry. Alrighty, I don't have a whole lot to add. Actually, what I had to say was probably more in the way of repetition to what has already been said. But I do want to pick up on a few themes that perhaps were not touched upon. Chapter 5 has quite a bit to say about Christ as the, well, you might say the second Adam. The sin and death came through Adam, but life and salvation came through Christ. So where first man failed, the man of God, Jesus, is the one who could redeem what Adam had lost by his fall into sin. The New England Primer, I think, discussed and encapsulated very well the idea of original sin when it said very tersely, in Adam's fall, we sinned all. And you see the little poetics there, in Adam's fall, we sinned all. We might add to that, in Jesus' life, we all stand tall. See, that's the contrast between Adam and Christ. Timaeus and Tom said quite a bit about justification and sanctification. These are terms that perhaps most of you are familiar with, but maybe some of you are not as familiar with as you would like to be. Justification, as the gentleman correctly stated, is that which God does for us. He brings us salvation through the merits of Jesus Christ. Sanctification is our response to what God has done for us. He calls us to a new life. Sanctus, a Latin word, means holy. In other words, living the God-style life that we have actually espoused by becoming children of God. So the one leads to the other, but the fact that we can lead sanctified lives, of course, as was pointed out correctly, depends upon us having the power of God working in us on a continual basis. And so Paul struggles with that kind of thing, as we saw in chapter 7, where he says, I do not understand my own actions, 7 verse 15. He has that Jekyll and Hyde struggle within him. It's a little bit like the musical Oklahoma, where one of the great songs has to do with the idea, I can't say no. And, you know, you get the idea here how we sometimes feel helpless in light of our weaknesses, and therefore, of course, the power of Christ is what brings Paul through, and it brings us through as we live out that life of sanctification. Chapter 8 is probably the one chapter that more people quote than any other, because it deals with life in the Spirit, and it says a lot about the idea of Christ within us. Paul is probably the one proponent of this concept, strongest proponent of the concept of Christ being within us. He often speaks about being in Christ, or the Spirit that empowers us. And so in chapter 8, that's brought out. Of course, the Spirit is also seen as the one who enables us to effectively pray. And as the thought is developed, that sometimes we don't even have the words to pray, but the Spirit enables our prayers to get through to God, even when we haven't got the right words. The fact that we have put ourselves on the line with God, the Spirit helps us in our prayer life. The concept of predestination is also taken up in chapter 8, but predestination means many things to many different people. There's, of course, the general Calvinistic view that if God wants some to be saved, it's logical that he planned that some would not be. Well, that's not a scriptural doctrine. I offended a Calvinist somewhere. Anyway, thank you for turning that off. Okay, you can go outside. You can go outside if you need to answer that. That's fine. Well, God wants all to be saved. The fact that not all are saved is not God's fault. It's certainly God's intention that all be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. The fact that some are not saved is not God's plan. It never was. It's because of the rejection of God or the ignorance of God that not all are saved.